voice, oh God. I thank you for what you're doing behind the scenes. Things I can't see with my eyes, can't hear with my ears, but God, we trust and believe you are at work doing something. Oh God, all I really have. And we praise you in advance, oh God. We give you a hallelujah and a thank you, Jesus, as if it's already done. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Come on, put your hands together. Woo, my God, amen. It's something about getting your praise on. It shifts the atmosphere. Hallelujah. And I'm so glad about it this morning. Well, good morning, overcomers in Christ. Family and friends and our dear visitors, God bless you, God bless you. Our live stream audience, God bless you. We love you, our supporters. And we greet you in the name of Jesus Christ. Because it's all about Him. Amen. I don't care what happens in our culture. It's still all about Him. Amen. Grab your word, if you would. Grab your Bible. Turn with me to Genesis 45. Amen. Isn't it a blessing to see Pastor Pat? My God. My Lord, hallelujah. That's nobody but God. Nobody but God. Y'all need to write that down. June 11th, 20. Pastor Pat was up shouting, pumped in, and just the same as they're doing all the things. Nobody but God. Amen. Are you in Genesis 45? Thank you for pressing your way to the house of God. I pray that the blessings of God will find you and overtake you. Every area, not just one area, every area of your life is blessed beyond measure. In Genesis 45, verses 5 to 9, I'm going to read from the New Living Translation, but if you can follow me in your Bible or on the screen. It says, don't be upset and don't be angry with yourself for selling me to this place. It was God who sent me here ahead of you to preserve your lives. The famine that has ravaged the land for 2 years will last 5 more years. And there will be neither plowing nor harvesting. God has sent me ahead of you to keep you and your families alive and to preserve many survivors. You see it in your Bible? So it was God who sent me here, not you. And He is the one who made me an advisor to Pharaoh, a manager of his entire palace, and governor of all Egypt. The grass withered, the flower faded, but the word of our God shall stand forever. Amen. You may have your seat in the presence of our life-changing King. Amen. Hallelujah. We've been in a series. Amen. We've been in a series. Amen. Position for purpose. Amen. And I pray that it has been a blessing to you. Amen. That we'll get this message number 4. All right. Number 4. Amen. Position for purpose. And so we're just asking God's blessing on this. Father, word my mouth. Oh God, God, let us be cheerful and receiving the word that will change our lives in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Woo, my God, are you ready for the word? Amen. Let's give this morning to you, amen, for the body of Christ. Your purpose is greater than yourself. Your purpose is greater than yourself. We've been talking about being positioned for purpose. We've been using Joseph's story, the story of Joseph from Genesis, the 37th chapter, and it goes all the way to Genesis 50. Amen. How God's hand was upon his life. Amen. As a young man, he had to go through many things, but his life was under the direction of God. Amen. And so, we've been trying to share with you that no matter where you are in life, you still have purpose. Amen. And we broke down what purpose is, and we broke down that God's preparation and the process, and we've just been working it in a series, in case you did not know. A series where you will hear repeated things so that you can get it in the depths of your heart. It won't be surface knowledge, and you are here. You're supposed to hear some things repeated over and over out of each message. And that's designed so it can resonate. It can get all the way saturated in your spirit. Because, truth be told, every one of us needs purpose. Amen. It's a sad commentary to go all through life, Pastor Pat, and say, I don't know my purpose. And so God desires that every man and woman discover his or her purpose, why? So that you can fulfill your God-given assignment here on earth. Your purpose won't matter once you get the glory. Somebody's just waiting until I get to heaven, then I'm going to start working. Well, your work was supposed to be here on earth, amen. That's why our purpose is greater than ourselves. One of the saddest testaments, amen, of our time is to look out over a graveyard and realize that so many departed life without fulfilling their God-given purpose. They did not fulfill what God has created them to do here on earth. But he has sought still to spare our lives and give us more time to get on the right pathway to purpose. Don't sit on me now. Come on. It's not because purpose wasn't in the folks. It's because they failed to go to God. Amen. Because my God has the blueprint and the plan for our lives. Am I right about it? Hallelujah. Even before we came out of the womb, God had already had a plan and a purpose for us. Amen. Tell you the truth, God created everything for a real purpose. It's not like he just says, I'm up here and I don't have nothing else to do. Amen. Just let me just create man. You know, I don't know what man's purpose is for, but I'm just going to create a man and a woman. No, when God brought you forth from your mother's womb, your assignment began. Many of us are going through nothing like this. God will always take something deep down on the inside. You may not know what it is at the time, but it's something that will not rest until you recognize it. It's something that you go to school, you go to college, and there's something still on the inside. It's something bigger that I need to be doing, but I can't put my hand on it. We go to the college, we go to professors, we go to counselors, but they don't have the answer for what's going on the inside. But God has your answer. But how many times we get involved in people, Mama, what you want me to do? Dad wants me to be this. Dad wants me. They don't have the blueprint for your life. How many people are living frustrated today trying to please somebody who has nothing to do with their purpose? It might be tight, but it's right. No matter where we find ourselves, God's purpose will prevail. Amen. Knowing that he works all things according to his purpose. Amen. The good news is it will happen in God's timing. I don't want to get ahead of myself. But in Isaiah 14 and 24, in the NIV translation, it says, "The Lord God, the Lord Almighty, has sworn sorely, as I have planned, so it will be. As I have purposed, so it will happen." Is that in your Bible? As He has purposed, it will happen. Amen. What God has planned and purposed, amen, is so much greater than where we are right now. Hallelujah. Yes, you may be in the pit, but it's greater than the pit. You may be on your way to Potiphar's house, but it's greater than Potiphar's house. Y'all got to read this story about Joseph. Why is fulfilling our purpose so important, Pastor John? Well, I'm glad you asked. Fulfilling our purpose gives meaning to our lives. When we have meaning, we find fulfillment. And when we find meaning and fulfillment in life, we live on the abundant side of the promise. See, we stand at the door in St. John 10 and 10 where it says, "And God, the devil, the destroyer, but the steal, kill, and destroy, but I've come that you might have life." We stop right there at life, but there's a comma. Go past the comma. When you're fulfilling your purpose, living a meaningful and fulfilled life, you live on the other side of the comma in abundant life. Can't speak for you, but I'm trying to get on the other side so I can live an abundant life, fulfilling the purpose and plan that God has for my life. Can somebody say, "Help me, Lord"? So God will fulfill His purpose for your life in Psalm 57 and 2. And it says, "I cry to God Most High." This is the revised standard. And I turn to God Most High, to God who fulfills His purpose for me. Oh, my God. Joseph didn't accidentally have a dream. It wasn't by accident. His dreams were created and designed by God for his life. It wasn't for his parents. It wasn't for his brothers. Amen. You're trying, many times we're trying to get our family on board. But what do you think? And what am I supposed to do? And God said, "I'm not calling your sisters and brothers, your parents. I'm calling you. And this is your assignment." At that time, Joseph was only 17 years old. He was spiritually immature. He couldn't handle his God-given assignment at that time, so God had to prepare him and develop him. So he couldn't understand why his brothers couldn't stand him. Every time he opened his mouth, they said, "Oh, here you go again." The Bible says they couldn't even say a kind word to him. It's one thing to be hated by outsiders, but when you're hated by your own blood relatives, that's another kind of hurt. You can shout all day, but when you try to go back to a toxic environment, when you still be able to shout, when you leave this place, amen, you just, "Oh, I'm on my way to heaven, and I'm so glad." Then you go home to a toxic environment. God's purpose never changed. And so God had to get him out of that situation, amen, hallelujah. And we see Joseph telling his brothers, "Listen, don't be upset at me. Don't be angry with yourself. Amen. We got to get past this, amen. God sent me here for a purpose. Amen. It was God who sent me ahead of you to preserve your life." Can I tell you, that's Joseph's purpose. He spoke it for God did this thing. You may have a hand, a piece of it, but it was all orchestrated by God. Someone is there anybody here today that says, I'm on the right path, and I know I'm in His limit. I know it was set up by God, and I'm going to keep my focus on Him and Him alone. The devil's going to try to distract you. He's going to try to pull you to the left and to the right. But Joseph was. Joseph remained faithful and loyal to his God. Just because you're in the valley today, don't lose your focus. That pit is nothing but a pit stop. Look, you can't get no lower than the pit. So all you got to do is look to the heel. From whence cometh my help? Where does your help come from? My help cometh from the Lord. I'm about to shout myself. Amen. My desire is for us to discover, amen, our purpose. And to fulfill the dream, amen, the vision, the purpose that He has given to us. Many people, well, I'm not dreaming. Well, that's all right. He's going to give you a vision. Well, what's the vision? It's being able to see without seeing. I'm not talking with your natural eyes. I'm talking through the eyes of faith. You've got to see. I sense something. I can see myself doing this. How I'm going to get there, only God knows. I see myself speaking in front of many people. I see myself helping in this department. Now, I'm way on the other side, and I don't know how God is going to get me from the pit to the palace, but I got to trust Him. Woo, my God. Now, if Sister testified this morning, there is things that's going to meet you on the road to destiny. There's going to be some pitfalls. There's going to be some hindrances, some blockages. There's going to be some temptations, but keep on moving. Keep moving in the right direction. Have you ever been on the right highway? You've been on the right interstate, but headed in the wrong direction? There's some church folks. They are not they're connected to God, but they're going the wrong direction. They're trying to make their own way. And when you make your own way, you're going to have to pay it. But when God does it, it's free. Y'all get that sometime this week. When God does it, it's free. Can you tell somebody when God does it? He takes the stress, the struggle, and the strain away. Woo! The way of a transgressor is hard. You've been fighting in your flesh, and God says, when, as soon as you put your flesh on the altar and give me a yes, Lord, let me take you to where I need you to be in this life. I'm fighting against God. The devil, well, baby, you just don't know my family. I'm supposed to know all of them. You are to propose to them. Listen, your family has nothing to do with your destiny. And the truth is, when you look at Joseph's story, it's your family that don't want you to meet your God-given obligation, your assignment. Can I tell you, sometimes you got to disconnect from family. You just don't know my family, Pastor. They try to control every aspect of my life. Put them on the altar. Love them from a distance. Touch them if you have to. I love you, but I'm moving. You my girl, but I'm moving. You my dog, but I'm moving. Because I can't stay in this environment and expect my assignment to be fulfilled. And if you don't move, God will make it uncomfortable. He had to make Joseph's environment uncomfortable so that he could get him out of there. I know this, y'all ain't going to hear this in 2023 from all over, but you here for a purpose. Amen. Amen. And so, here's Joseph. And God had a plan and a purpose, and so Joseph realized through somewhere through the course of his struggle, his pain, his suffering, I must have something bigger for me. When he realized, when he began to break down, he saw that his brothers bowed into his mother and his father, that he wasn't spiritually mature to put it all together. He had to be developed. Today, I'm telling you, somebody needs to be developed this morning. It's not that God don't love you, but, and I told you this several Sundays ago. I don't understand it all, but God uses pain and suffering and struggle to develop his people. It is called the process. And too many, when the pressure is on, the pain is at an all-time high, we want to run and I can't take this, I can't help it. But listen, for a diamond that y'all wear in all your ears and all your nose and all the other places, that diamond had to be refined. That diamond had to go through the fire to come out looking that good. Now, if the diamond had to go through it, guess what? You got to go through it. So that, listen, ooh, this is so good. Let me put my own off in there. When you're in the furnace of affliction, God is getting rid of the toxic in your life. When you are in the furnace of affliction, y'all know what it is to take probiotics. You know what it is to do all the other things. What they say, prune to be God. That's the word. We had a doing our fast. Well, a couple years ago, it was called soul detox, where God is trying to get the toxins out of our life. Because when you get to your place of purpose, woo, you don't have time for all of this junk to be still in your heart. No. You got to get delivered. You can't get to your place of purpose and still messing around with the normal things. Y'all know what I'm talking about. We ain't got to go there. You know what it is. But when God has you in the furnace, the good news, while you're in the furnace of affliction, he gets in the furnace with you. Hallelujah. Somebody need that encouragement this morning. In your furnace of affliction, the master is right there with you. He's not going to take the fire out of it, but he's going to make you better in it. So the next time you up against that situation, you say, oh, God, I've been here before. You can't touch me now. You should have killed me when you had it there. Hallelujah. Amen. What happened is God will give us the grace to outlast the devil. We say, nay, endure for a night. But I got some prayer for you today. Joy cometh in the morning. Your purpose is greater than yourself. That is why God sees the big picture. He sees beyond your current situation and circumstance. And as long as he, that's why it's so necessary to make sure you, when the church door is open, make your way to the house of God. At any moment when you walk in, God meets you here. He will give you that special touch, that assurance, that's the word. Lord, I know you, I see you. God, I know what you're going through, but in my house, you can't find this in the grocery store. You can't find this nowhere else but in the house of God. And when the praises go up, blessings come down. How many want a blessing from God? Oh, I've been going through some situations. I've been dealing with some issues, but if I could just press my way to the house of God, if I can just get to the altar, if I can just get around with spirit-like folks with the same spirit of faith, speaking my language. See, a lot of times we want to confide in our co-workers, but they're not speaking our language. We want to talk to family and friends, but they're not speaking. uses the language that God understands. Because the best thing we can do when we're in the valley and it looks like every avenue of ours is cut off, I'm going to pray my way through it. That praise you sent up today means something to God. You aren't just putting on no show. That praise, your feet is testifying of the goodness and the mercy of God. Woo! I don't want no rock crying out in my place. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. In every opportunity I get, I want to lift my hand and say, Lord, I thank you. Every opportunity, I want my feet to say, Lord, I thank you. Thank you for the struggle. Thank you for the pain. Because it's making me better. Hallelujah. Amen. Nothing's just happened. Everything's got to stay so connected to God in this season. Culture is trying to call wrong right and right wrong. But we can't bow down to what the culture is doing. Or what they're saying. Amen? Another thing that God does when He is developing us, when we're being spiritually developed, amen, He sees beyond the flesh of us. Amen? He sees the weight of our past, the failures, the flaws, and the faults that we have. But can I tell you, His purpose will never change because of your failure. His purpose will never change because of our flaws and our faults. Amen. Hallelujah. He knows the insecurities that we're clinging on to. Amen. He knows the fear of failure. I know God is calling me to do this, but I'm afraid to step out by faith. I know He's telling me to move from A to B, but fear is tripping my faith. And we already know fear is designed to paralyze our faith. Amen. In spite of all of these, amen, God still promises better things are coming. I got to keep moving. My time is moving. The next thing I want you to know, sister, is we must follow God's lead and God's direction. When we are being positioned for purpose, amen, we must trust God's judgment and plan for our lives. Amen. See, trusting God needs to be the number one stepping stone. Amen. On our path to purpose. If you don't trust God, how can you obey Him? If you're not trusting God with your destiny, you will not obey when He says, turn left. You'll be like, why, Lord? I want to go right. You're just going to hold up the whole process. And God is a God. He allows us some leeway because we got free will. And some people haven't reached their destiny yet because of stubbornness. Being stiff-necked. Y'all know the children of Israel went around the mountain 40 years. How long are you going to keep going around doing the same thing and expecting different results? Amen. So the question is, do you trust God to lead you to the place of purpose for your life? Romans 12:2 says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Is it in your Bible? That ye may prove what that is good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. See, when we trust God, and when we give Him and submit to Him, at the same time, He is conformed. We are conforming to God's way of thinking. Amen. He begins to impregnate us with His thoughts, His mind, amen. Knowing the mind of Christ, all we have to do is stay in a posture of yes, Lord. Many Christians today that have been in church for years, Pastor Pat, can say, I don't know God's voice. They will tell you, there's a preacher on the YouTube. On the YouTube. Who is saying, God does not speak to us today. Everything He says is already written. But I beg to differ. Now, people ask a question about the audio and all the other things. but God will put an impression upon your spirit. Has that happened to anybody? He will impress upon you. See, today, in today's churches, we say something told me. In the old church, they say the Holy Ghost spoke to me. Come on, I'm going to tell you the truth. When Mama and Grandma now got up to testify, they said the Holy Ghost told me that everything's going to be all right. Today, we're saying, something told me to go help that person. I don't know what it is. You don't know. The devil's not going to tell you to do all the things right and helping and serving. The devil's going to tell you to hurt them, talk about it, gossip, and do all the crazy things. But when you're filled with the Holy Ghost, hallelujah, we got to allow the Holy Ghost to work in and through our lives. That's why I can't understand when churches don't preach. You need to be filled with the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost, oh, let me tell you, it gives you the power to live out your purpose. It is the power of God. It is the Spirit of God that He imparts upon your life to do what you've been called and purpose to do. Somebody say, I can't live without it. Hallelujah. Amen. And Joseph had to come to a place where in his assignment and his purpose, if he don't get in the right place and position, somebody's gonna die. He said, God sent me here to preserve your life. Had he not obeyed and trusted God when the famine came, he would have been out of place and out of position. He had to go through the pit. He had to go through Potiphar's house. And all to prison. Why? See, when God is developing us, amen, He's not just doing it because He don't have nothing else to do. When we get to our place of purpose, we can't be just learning how to say amen, thank you, Jesus. When you get to your place of purpose, you're going to have to be spiritually mature to handle the challenges of life. When Joseph got to the palace, he was 30 years old. He started at 17, God working. Can you see 13 years of preparation? You got a bishop now, people walking around saying, I'm a bishop, been saved a year. You don't know A from B. Up from there. And you say, you a bishop, you ain't been through nothing. You haven't been proven. When you say, I'm a bishop, I'm a pastor, I'm an evangelist, prophet, and a pastor, you need to have gone through the fire and know that God has really called you. That's free. I ain't even going to charge y'all for that. Amen. And so, in the process of being developed, God will grace you. He will give you the grace. What is grace? God's ability to do something you couldn't do in your own strength. He will give you the grace to succeed. He don't give you grace to fall down and fail at your assignment. He gives you grace to provide. And all of our purpose, all that He has assigned, is to bring Him glory. God is not going to get you to your place of purpose for you to keep falling. That woman was so fine, Lord. You've been going through the same thing for 40 years. Some people can't turn down a hamburger. I'm strong, and a hamburger will tempt them to do something they ain't got no business doing. Y'all will get that next week. Amen. When we get to our place and fulfill our purpose, amen. When God would begin to work on David, y'all remember him. When he was first anointed, he was somewhere between 15 and 20 years old. It took another 15 years before he actually became king. He was in preparation. All right, that's all I believe. Abraham was 25 years old when he first received the promise of a seed, of a son. It wasn't until he was 100 years old when that promise came to pass. It's in your Bible. Now, in is the minimal the patrons of old had to go through the process and beat the devils. Why do you want a microwave purpose? Born today, in tomorrow, that ain't going to happen. It's not going to happen. The same processes of going through and develop you, building up your faith. Because some people, listen, even during the pandemic, something beyond our control, people haven't come back to church yet. They have had a pandemic. Put them off their course. I just want to watch my Lord and Savior from the TV. They called the TV a one-eyed devil when I was coming up. I don't know what they call the TV now. But you, it's more to it than that. Our purpose is greater than ourselves. Amen. And we need the working of the Holy Spirit, amen, to reveal God's plan to us so that we can fulfill His purpose and power. Like, I can't finish. Stand to your feet. You got to hear the rest of the story Wednesday night. Amen. Well, we pray on Wednesday night. Oh, Lord, so I ask next Sunday, all right? Amen. Father's Day next Sunday, so amen. So, amen. We're going to work our purpose. We're going to, with the help of the Holy Ghost. As He begins to open the eyes of our understanding, God, my life needs purpose. I've been praying. I've been going here. I've been doing this. But I haven't been real serious. And when there's no seriousness here, it means not a lot. Well, if I do, if I don't, then you ain't serious. And what happens is all you're doing is delaying what really supposed to be taking place in your life. And the longer you look, we had a pastor, Elder Grace. Remember, he just said, don't be a repeat. Learn the lesson and keep moving. But if you keep repeating, y'all know repeating first grade, repeating second grade, you 18 in the third grade. Something wrong. You've been in church 5 years and still don't know how to pray. Don't know how to call on the Lord. You still dipping and diving in sin. Something is wrong. And you're wondering why you're spiritually struggling. You think you can hide it from people, but you can't hide it from God. Amen. Hallelujah. Your purpose is greater than yourself. Amen. Listen to the song.
Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Just now. Just now. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, just now. He will save you, He will save you, He will save you, just now, just now. He will save you. He will save you just now. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus just now. Just now, come to Jesus, come to Jesus, just now.
Heads bow, eyes closed. You know what you need. You know what you need in your life. You know what God is trying to push you to your purpose. You know what has been hindering you, what's been trying to block your pathway. Today, God is saying, if you just say, yes, Lord, I surrender my all to you. The song was sang today, I give myself away. Amen. God is saying, I want all of you. I don't want part of you in another place and then part of you in the church. I want all of you. I want you to serve me with your whole heart, your mind, your spirit, your soul. Amen. Many times we get on the altar and God is saying, you got to give me all of it. Just don't give me a piece of you. I want all of you. I want your whole mind, body, and soul saturated in the Holy Ghost. So when you go out amongst them, you'll have some power. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, we thank you this morning, God, for your word. We thank you for the power of the Holy Ghost. Oh, in the name of Jesus, God, we thank you for breakthrough anointing. We thank you because that issue no longer has power over our minds. That thing has no longer power over our situation. But God, I thank you this morning. We're coming out with our hands up. Oh, God, in victory, oh, God, we are overcomers in Christ because of the blood that was shed on Calvary's cross. I thank you, oh, God, for our salvation. And, Father, we thank you and call it that one man, that woman that's at the crossroad of life that don't know which way to turn. Father, lead them and guide them. Let them make a wise decision to choose you this day for whom they will serve. Father, as we go the rest of the week, let your anointing lead us and guide us. God, we want to follow your lead and your direction. God, on our way to perfect soul child. God, I thank you because now we have a better understanding that our purpose is greater than ourselves. And God, if we don't get to purpose, somebody is liable to die. And Father, I thank you for fulfilling your purpose in our lives. And we call it done in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Come on, put your hands together. Hallelujah. Your